Hello students, welcome to the online tutorial for Vidyabhavan High Secondary School. This video is for class 11 science. In this video I'll continue with the chapter classification of the living world. Okay, so let's not waste any more time and let's get started with the chapter classification of the living world. So now we will read about the vegetative structure in lichen. Okay, so what are the vegetative structures? There are mainly 5 to 6 vegetative structures we will read about. So first one is siphellae. What is this siphellae? It is the circular depression, or you can say a circular groove, okay, within a cortical region of the lichen. And what is its function? Its function is mainly for gaseous exchange. It's a specialized structure and it is made up of round cells and it is meant for gaseous exchange. Okay, next, number 2 is breathing pores. Now by the name you can understand that breathing pores that helps in obviously breathing or respiration, or you can say gaseous exchange. It is also present in the cortical region, but it is interwoven. Interwoven means it is network like, a net like, you can say, like this. Okay, this type of structure present also in the cortical region. Okay, now there are some pore like structures present within it which functions as the, or which mainly functions for the gaseous exchange. Okay, and sometimes what happens, these breathing pores raise above the surface and it looks like a cone like structure. Okay, that means it looks like a cone like structure after the swelling. So these are the breathing pores. Number 3 is pseudocyphellae. Pseudo means false. So what is this pseudocyphellae? These are the simple, smaller, less differentiated patches, or you can say cracks. Okay, irregular cracks occurring on the lower cortical region with some medullary tissues. Okay, so these are the pseudocyphellae. Next, number 4. The next is the cephalodia. Okay, what happens over here? As in the lichen, we have seen that lichen is the combination or mutualism between a fungi and an algae. But in case of cephalodia, these are the special type of lichen which is formed by the combination of 2 algae and 1 fungi. What are the 2 algae? One is blue-green algae, another one is the green algae combining with 1 fungi. Okay, and what happens, these algae actually separated by each other by some dark colored gall like structures. Okay, and it is and formed by internal swellings. Those gall like structure, those internal swelling like structure is termed as the cephalodia. Okay, next, number 5, soredia. Now what is this soredia? What happens that it is a minute non-cortical, okay, round, that means non-cortical means it is not growing on the cortex region. Okay, round bud like outgrowth. Okay, round in shape and bud like outgrowth present on the upper surface of the lichen. Okay, and what happens, it is made up of few algal cells and few fungal hyphae. Okay, that means both the cells are there, fungal hyphae as well as the algal cells. And what is the main function of this soredia? This helps in vegetative propagation. What is vegetative propagation? A way of vegetative reproduction. Okay, the 6th one is the icedia. It is to some extent same with this soredia, but there are differences that it is also meant for vegetative propagation. This is also found on the upper surface of the lichen. This is also formed of the algal cells and the fungal hyphae, but the main difference is that it is coral shaped. Okay, and it is corticated, that means it is found on the cortex and it is of coral shaped. But this soredia is non-corticated and it is a bud like round shaped outgrowth. So these are the vegetative structures in lichen. Now I will next read about the economic importance of lichen. Now I will see the economic importance of lichen, that means for how much it is important economically. First of all, food. Okay, we can get food for the cattle, for the sheep, for reindeer from these lichens. Like reindeer moss is a food for the reindeer. Iceland moss is the food for the cattle, sheep, and it is also consumed by some humans. So these reindeer moss, Iceland moss, these are being obtained from different lichen. Next is a drugs, or you can say medicine. Different types of drugs and medicines are being prepared from different lichens, which are used in different diseases, mainly lung diseases and respiratory diseases, TB, or you can say tuberculosis. For these diseases, the drugs that are being obtained from the lichen are being highly used for curing these diseases. Next coming dyes, or you can say color. So different brown colored dyes are being formed from the lichen. Okay, some particular lichen produces brown colored dye, which is helpful for dyeing the wool, the silk fibers. Okay, now the litmus paper that we use in the laboratory experiment, those litmus paper are being obtained or are being produced from this lichen. So these are the importance. Next coming perfumes, and the incense sticks. These perfumes and the incense sticks are being prepared from the lichens. Okay. Next is that the lichen is a very good pollution indicator. It indicates the pollution or how much a region is polluted, because they do not grow and thrive in a polluted region. That means if there is no lichen in a region, that means we will understand that region is highly polluted. And if the region is having a good population of the lichen, then we can understand that yes, this region is pollution free. So this was all about the economic importance of lichen, and this is all about the topic of the lichen. Next topic, we will move on to the virus and viroids. So what is this virus? Virus are microscopic, or you can say ultra microscopic, disease causing organism. That means ultra microscopic. Obviously all these viruses, bacteria, they are harmful to the mankind or to the living organisms. Okay, capable of introduced within the living cells. Okay, it is a nucleoprotein entities. Nucleoprotein means it is made up of nucleoprotein. That means it can, the genetic material can be RNA or DNA. Okay. Next, number three is that it is, when introduced into the specific organisms, it is capable of multiplying itself within the host cell. That means capable of multiplying itself. So these are the general characteristics of the virus. Now we will see about viroids. Viroids, what are the points? Number one, it is the naked particle. That means it is without the covering. I mean naked particle. That means it doesn't have the covering. Number two is that it is made up of free ribonucleic acid in which protein coats are absent. That means it is made up of free RNA without protein coats. Number three, that it is generally smaller in size and the RNA is single-stranded, linear or circular. That means smaller in size, and viruses are generally larger than the viroids. And the fourth one is that it affects the plant only. It affects the plants only, whereas the viruses, they affect all the plants and all the other organisms. Okay. So these are the general characteristics of virus and viroids and general differentiation between virus and viroids. Now we will move on to the next topic. Now we will move on to the living characteristics and non-living characteristics of viruses. There are three living characteristics of virus. First of all, presence of the nucleoprotein. That means presence of DNA or RNA. Obviously, because DNA and RNA, they generally be found in the living organisms, not in the non-living ones. Number two is that it can reproduce, as I've said, in the previous thing only, that it can reproduce within the host cell. Number three, that it can infect the other living organisms. That means obviously it can infect others. So by depending on these three characteristics, we can say that yes, it is the living characters. Now the next is that why viruses are considered as the non-living things. Number one, their molecules can be converted into crystals. That means virus molecules can be converted to crystals. Generally, the living molecules or the living the cells cannot be converted to crystals. But in this case, it is the exception. Number two, it has no cell membrane, no cytoplasm. Cytoplasm is the thing by which an organism can be identified as living or non-living. So it has no cytoplasm, no cell membrane. It does not show locomotion. So no locomotion as well. Okay. Number four. It says that it cannot respond to external stimuli. Can't respond to stimuli. Okay. No metabolic functions within the virus's body. Number six, that means no metabolic functions is occurring or is taking place within the virus body. Number six is that it remains inactive outside the host body. So these are the non-living characteristics. Okay. So that is why virus is considered as the intermediate between living and non-living. Okay. That means outside extracellular phase is that in this phase what happens? The virus completely behaves like inanimate objects and can be crystallized. And what is the intracellular phase? That is in this phase the virus behaves like animate object, that means living object within the host body. And by the help of enzymes of the host organism, they can synthesize the structural material and can multiply. And as it is showing both the characteristics or both the phases like extracellular and intercellular, that is why they are regarded as the intermediate between the living and non-living. Now sometimes virus is termed as the acellular. What is acellular? A means absence. Okay, that means absence of the cellular level. Okay. Why it is called so? Because it has no power to grow and work independently. Okay. Number B, that for different functions of the cell, a minimum space of 500 nanometer diameter is necessary. But viruses have no shape and size. Next is that because viruses diameter tends to about 100 nanometer to 200 nanometer, viruses can be crystallized. No living cell shows this type of phenomena. Enzymes, cytoplasm and other cell organelles, cell membranes, all these are absent. So all these absence of the cellular level, for this reason the viruses are termed as the acellular. Now this virus is of generally three types: plant virus, animal virus and then the bacteria virus, or you can say bacteriophage. Now we will go for the structure. The generally external structure is rod shaped or cuboidal or anything like the structure, but internal structure, the internal part is generally of two, composed of two parts. Number one, it is the capsid or outer membrane. And the inner part is called nucleoid. The nucleoid is nothing but the RNA or DNA or anything, the protein part of the nucleic acid part of the virus, which is situated at the core portion of the virus body. Okay. Now this surrounding this nucleoid, there is the layer or it's a covering. Now that covering is termed as the capsid. Now the capsid, the unit of the capsid, that is several, there are several units togetherly merge up to form this outer membrane of the capsid. Now each of these units are termed as capsomeres. Okay, now these capsid and nucleic acid or nucleoid togetherly form nucleocapsid. Okay, and surrounding the nucleic capsid, there is the envelope which is protecting the entire virus. So, this was all about the today's video. In my next video, I'll continue with the next part of the chapter. Thank you.